Well, the neuromorphs are a large group of diverse researchers, scientists from around the world.
We're interested in studying the intersection of where engineering and neuroscience and cognitive science come together.
All kinds of people interested in how the brain works.
We're trying to understand how to build cognitive systems.
The neuromorphs are people who are interested in two fields, which are normally very far apart from each other.
Their common interest is really in trying to understand how the brain computes.
Are those that actually started using technology to make artificial systems, actually looking at the brain and the neurons.
In these 3 weeks, we get all the people, all the neuromorphs in the world that work on these things together, and we exchange ideas.
We have engineers, we have biologists, we have neuroscientists, we have people that are really involved in different areas in their home research institutions. And so kind of the idea really is that we can take this opportunity to play around and learn a lot of different techniques from different people.
Some people want to make things that work in the real world, want to make products. Some people are interested in just understanding how the brain works, and they use the technology as a tool to make progress in basic research, basic science.
What makes our group unique really is that the models that we're trying to develop or understand or implement really are, we're trying to test neural algorithms in practical situations.
Why are we doing this at all, right? Why this is useful at all? So there's the obvious answer is to understand the brain, how we work. And that has tremendous implications. It has tremendous implications when you're talking about computation. We are tremendously effective and efficient in many tasks that computers fail.
We have to be able to build machines that can interact in the environment the same way that humans or animals, dogs and cats and so on do.
We're trying to understand how when you make a motor system move the robot, how it feeds back directly in real time to the sensory information. And oftentimes what you find is that when you have a robot interacting with the world in real time, the problem actually changes.
How do you build machines that can really, work in the environment the way that we do?
Completely easy for us to do. It's very hard to build in a machine, and that's what we're trying to do.
Anytime you build hardware or a system that can work in real time and solve a problem like tracking or discrimination or using attentional systems, they advance the state of the art in understanding larger autonomous systems.
If we understand actually the brain, we can actually help in helping the ones that have problems, for instance, they had lesions in the brain, that have a traumatism, have had a stroke, etc. So these people, or they have some sort of neurological disease.
The point of being here is really to learn, to try and understand something about how the brain works. And not just how it works, but how would we build it?
And all together, which as a big family, we try to make progress.
So what we have here is actually this robot looking through his eyes. So he has two cameras over there. And it's able to recognize when I'm facing him. So it recognizes my face. If you look here at the computer, you will see that my face is sort of surrounded with a square. And what this robot does at the moment, we have implemented a gazing behavior. It's able to follow my face anywhere I move. So this is one of the basic behaviors we need if we want to have a meaningful interaction. We have to allow him to look at our face and recognize what we're doing. The other aspect we're working on is the communication. But you see that he has no arms, and we're very limited at that. So we use facial expressions as means of communication, okay? And since we have cameras here, he can interpret what we're doing. The idea here is that using our facial expression as feedback, it can learn how to interact with us, to please us, and to engage us in a meaningful interaction. What we've done so far is we've actually made him to mimic our facial expression. So if I look at him, he will recognize his face, he will gaze at me, and then if I smile, he will smile back at me. Stop smiling, and then disappear. If I disappear, we'll go back to It's actually seeing your face. It's following you. And it has a repertoire of facial expressions. So if I, for instance, now go with a sad face, or surprise face, you see, it mimics it. And the idea is, these are basic behaviors that we will need then to establish this interaction with the user. We are halfway through, but this is the very basic, and you see, our robot has already some means of expressing and communicating with us, and also of analyzing our behavior. Now, with our brain-based models, we're going to try to learn how to interact with persons.
Hey, come closer.
You don't need the power adapter. You throw the wall out, just one box in the wall.
Hey, come closer.
Just a physical adapter. It doesn't need to go back. The white box.
Go away, I'm tired.
Let's go.
Let's go and eat while I come back and finish packing.
No, let's wait 15 minutes and ready the packing. Let's go and eat.
It should actually try to call my attention, right? So, you see the camera over there? If you can look with the camera. That's an overhead tracking. With that, I'm tracking my position, so the robot knows where I am. And what his task is to drive my attention, but nobody explained him how to do that. And this is why you're listening now to, come closer, come closer. He has this neutral face now, and it's saying eventually, come closer. And this is a behavior he learned. He could say three words, three sentences. Come closer, could say go away, or could give a kiss as reward, right? And what he's learned is that actually to engage me in an interaction, he has to say come closer. We'll heard this again. When I come closer, he gives me a reward as a kiss, and he smiles back to me, right? If I go, then he's gonna do exactly the same thing. He's gonna try to drive my attention. It's going to do some vocalization. It said again, come closer, right? And then I come close. If I'm in his field of view, he looks at me, smiles back at me, and gives me a reward. But all of this wasn't programmed. So he learned this after interacting with us. We just told him, you can do move the head right, you can move the head left, you can say these three sentences, and that's it.
Okay, we're here in Kapakachi at 2011 in the disco. People are working on projects, and we have here one project, which is the robotic labyrinth game, which uses this hacked up Rio labyrinth game, the silicon retina, which you can see right here looking down onto the table. On the table, there's a ball rolling around, and on the side of the table, we packed up servos here, which control the knob dummies on the table. You can see here, there's a little servo arm here controlling one knob, and then over here is another knob. And then these servos go to this little servo board, which goes to USB, just as the retina here goes to USB. And then these both go over here to this laptop. On this laptop here, the output data from the retina is processed. For example, you can hear it here, the spikes from the ball. If you just put a mark somewhere where the ball is, you can hear occasionally as the ball goes by, there's a spike event. So you have this very sparse stream of data from the retina. But anyway, you can now use that to track the ball and then control these servos here to try to put the ball where you want it to be. Okay, here the labyrinth game is negotiating like a virtual maze because of the problem of these black lines here, these ones. Now you see them? These ones here on the table causing data from the retina that makes it hard to track the ball, which after all is just like a silver ball on a white table. We created a virtual maze here on the computer, and the ball is kind of following along these dots. And when it gets to the end here, it shoots to the other side of the table, and then it starts over on that side of the table there. You can see it's not really stable, quite stable enough to negotiate a real maze, but it is following the line here. You see, it's kind of going down, then it goes up this path to the top, then it goes to the right here, and then it shoots up to the upper right corner, then it goes down here, goes around that spot here, comes down, comes to the end, and then it shoots to the beginning again. So it is controlling okay, not perfectly stable, but it's controlling on this virtual table, not too bad. And now in the next demonstration, I will now pick a point, I will just take over from the maze and just pick a point on the upper right here. And so now it's trying to control the ball here to the upper right of the table, and now I'll pick to the point to the lower left, then it controls to the lower left, and now I'll go to the lower right. All right, so it tries to control to the lower right, and now to the upper left. See, it kind of arced over there, and now back to the lower right. And now I'll hold a spot in the middle of the table. Okay, so that's about the radius. It holds a spot to a radius of maybe 3 ball diameters right now, which is not really quite stable enough to negotiate a real maze, even if you could track the ball perfectly with all the distractors here. Of the black lines of the walls and the maze itself. And now I'll show you the computer display, which you can see here, which shows the tracking of the ball. This green thing here shows where the ball is being tracked. This red thing shows where it's trying to go, or actually this green dot here shows where it's trying to go, so I can move the green dot to where I like. Now it controls the ball over there. Now I'll move it up here. Controls it up here. And the whole thing is controlled by a molar parameters here in this GUI, which for instance set the proportional gain, the controller forward prediction delay, the derivative gain, etc. There's a bunch of them. These signals over here are kind of interesting. They actually show the real controller PID output. So the different colors here are the PID terms of the controller. And for example, you can see here, because of built-in mismatch on the table, you do need some integral term to cancel out the offset on the table tilt. And that's the blue arrow that builds up after a while at one point on the table. That concludes this demonstration.